just need to relax, sit back, and have your iman, wherever it is, go up. And feel empowered. Empowered about how special you are and how just by you being Muslim can change the world. Please help me welcome a very special guest who's traveled all the way from Phoenix, Arizona tonight to be with us. My friend, Mr. Terry Holbrooks.
If you guys want to go to the bathroom, go ahead. Really,
he likes
I'm serious.
To stretch so you don't get
like
tired.
You just listen to him for an hour and a half. If you want to go to the bathroom, now would be a good time. Go ahead and do it now. Take a couple minutes, stretch, do whatever you need to do. That way you don't have to get up in the midst of me talking. Nobody wants to go to the bathroom?
That's fine, go on.
Nobody ate, I guess? Nobody needs to go to the bathroom?
Enjoy.
That's interesting.
They're comfortable.
Hey, in the back, can you hear me?
Yes.
Awesome. I don't like microphones. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you for having us here this evening. For those of you who were able to listen to Brother Khalil for the entire time, thank you. I understand that was probably taxing on you. That was probably very difficult to do. He has a lot to say, and it's very dry material. It's very dense. It's like being back in college again. It's like listening to a lecturer from a professor. So. Alhamdulillah, I'm surprised that you could do it. I couldn't even do it. Alhamdulillah. I was born in Phoenix, Arizona in 1983. I've lived in Phoenix all of my life. With the exception of when I was in the military, I have always been in Phoenix. For those of you who've never been to Phoenix, Phoenix is a lot like Medina in the summer. It's hot. That's all there is to say. 115, 120 degrees, it's not pleasant. My mother and father weren't necessarily in a good position when they had me to have a child. They weren't ready to be parents. They were 17 and 18 respectively. As a result of such, I was raised by my grandparents. My grandfather was from England. He was a strong Catholic. My grandmother was from Virginia. She was a Protestant. Being that the two of them were divided upon faith, neither one of them told me that I had to be one or the other, because that would be putting down one of the two. They didn't tell me that I had to be a Catholic. They didn't tell me that I had to be a Protestant. They told me to be a good person. They told me to treat people the way that I would want to be treated, to treat people with respect, to value my education, to be a good individual overall. In a home that doesn't have religion, I think that's probably the best advice that you could give to a child. I took some of it a bit too seriously, such as the valuing of my education. When I got to high school, I started realizing that what we were learning in high school, what our textbooks were teaching us, wasn't actually history. And this isn't very difficult for a kid to figure out. You know, you can turn a history channel on and read a little bit about what's going on in World War II in your school book, and you'll see that there's a difference between the two. The television is telling you facts, and the history book is telling you history from the perspective of the Americans. As a result of such, I started spending a great deal of time studying on my own. So much so that I finished high school at the age of 16. I took AP classes, I took college classes, I got out of high school. It's a waste of time. If you guys have a private school that you can be sending your students to, send them. They'll get a much better education, I assure you. I then went to a trade school for audio engineering called the Conservatory of Recording Arts and Sciences. I finished there with a degree at about the age of 17 and a half. And as 18 was coming, I was realizing that I was going down the same road that my father had gone down. I had these great educational accomplishments, but I didn't have structure and order. I didn't have discipline. I wasn't really an adult. I hadn't really developed into a man. I hadn't had that final push that you get when you kicked out of the nest, so to say. So as I was going down the same road that my father was, I was staying out all night, I was drinking and driving, I was spending way too much time playing billiards, playing pool. I probably covered both of my arms in tattoos before I turned 18. I definitely had them both covered by the time I was 18. I was turning into somebody that I didn't want to be. I knew that I had a brain on my shoulders. I knew that I could do more. I was just lazy. I was the average American. I was white, grew up in America. I was entitled. I never had to work for anything. I was lazy. So one night, I was sitting there channel surfing, and I heard a commercial that said, "Be all that you can be." That's when the light bulb went off. That's what I was looking for. That's what I needed. I wanted to be all that I could be. I needed to grow up. I needed to become an adult. I needed that oomph. So the next morning I woke up and I went to the recruiters and I walked in and I said, hey, I want to join the Army. And he looks at me and he says, that's okay. We don't need you. Have a good day. And I walked out, lit up a cigarette, and I thought to myself, I wonder why the guy said no. You know, is there something wrong with me? Am I not good enough to join the Army? Why would this guy say no? And when I got home, I realized that perhaps being covered in tattoos and having piercings and having blue hair isn't what the Army is looking for. See, back in 2002, all the hip kids, all the cool kids were joining the military. That was the cool thing to do, not wearing tight pants and having iPhones like kids today. So my recruiter saw me and he's like, you know, I don't want this one. This one looks like trouble. If I just wait a little longer, maybe the football team will come. Maybe somebody from the basketball team, you know. I'm going to hold out. I'll get someone better. So that night, I shaved my head. I took out a lot of my jewelry. I went out and bought a long sleeve shirt. I went back to the recruiter a few days later and I said, hey, I want to join the Army. He says, that's okay. We still don't need you. I know, that's how I felt. I was crying. My options were limited. I had to work at Taco Bell. I wanted to go. She understands.
Yeah.
She can feel, she can relate. About a week later, I went there again, third time. Hey, I want to join the Army. Recruiter says to me, why do you want to join the Army? I want to kill people and get paid for it. Why does anybody join the Army? It's a dumb question. Well, that wasn't the answer that he wanted, so he sent me along my way. Fourth time, I went to the recruiter. Mind you, 9/11 had happened. We were going to war with Iraq for some reason. We still haven't figured it out 12 years later, but we went to war with Iraq for some reason. We needed soldiers. But this guy was saying no to me over and over and over. Fourth time, I come in. He realizes that I have tenacity. I'm not going to give up. I'm going to keep coming. I'm going to keep asking. So he says, here's what we'll do. I'm going to take you downtown. I'm going to let you take your ASVAB. We'll see how you score on your ASVAB. If you score well, we'll talk. If you don't score well, we won't talk. That'll be the end of it. You'll just be too dumb. He was hoping that I would score badly, so that way he could tell me, you're too dumb. Stop coming here. I went downtown, took my ASVAB, and by the time I got home, I had two missed voicemails from my recruiter. He wanted to have breakfast the next day. I was happy about this. We went out to breakfast and somehow managed to spend $60 on eggs and cantaloupe and, you know, normal breakfast things. I don't know how we spent $60, but he took me out to a nice restaurant. He had some Phoenix Suns tickets because the Suns were playing the Lakers in the playoffs. This is back when Kobe was still good and people liked him. And we had Nash on our team. You know, it was a good time for basketball. My recruiter became my best friend. We sat back down in the office, and he asked me, what is it you want to do in the military? And that's when I made the mistake of asking, what job is giving a bonus? When you say that to a recruiter, that's about the sweetest words that they can possibly hear. Because they know that for a little bit of extra money, you're going to go to the worst duty station, you're going to take the worst job, and you're going to sign up for a long time thinking that you got the best deal because you got a little bit of money. What job is giving a bonus is how I became a military police officer in the United States Army. I had no interest in being a police officer. I do not like police officers. To this day, I do not like police officers. When I was a police officer, I did not like police officers. Same thing goes for TSA and security and just about anybody who has a badge and uniform. I don't feel comfortable around them. You give somebody with a small mind a little bit of power and bad things happen. I was an example of that. So in August 2002, I went off to basic training in Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. I finished basic training in December and I was the unfortunate person to be stationed in Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. Everybody else got to go somewhere fun, whether it was Korea or Germany or elsewhere. I got stationed in Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. That's kind of how I felt about it, actually. I cried and whined a little. I got married in March of 2003. I found out in May of 2003 that I was going to Guantanamo. I didn't think to myself to go home and Google Guantanamo, and if I did, I probably would have spelled it wrong. I don't really think there's many Americans that can spell Guantanamo properly. It's not that hard of a word to spell, but we're not bilingual people. We're not trilingual people. Most of us can't speak English properly. I thought to myself, I just got married 2 months ago. I want to make sure that I have a solid marriage. I want to make sure that I have a strong foundation so that when I come home, my wife is still here. I spent every day that I had before we left spending it with my wife, making sure that I had laid down the foundation, the groundwork was there, that she was going to be waiting for me. She gave up her whole life. She moved halfway across the country to come to Missouri, one of the worst places in the United States. She literally moved from Phoenix to the meth capital of the U.S. to live with me. And here I am going to Guantanamo for a year. We had 2 weeks of training to work in Guantanamo. I find it interesting, 2 weeks to work in a prison unlike any prison anywhere in the world. I was on a prison guard. I didn't know how to be a prison guard. But the Army thought that 2 weeks was sufficient training. We conducted this training in Fort Dix, New Jersey, which does not have a correctional facility. So we made a fake correctional facility with PVC pipes and plastic wire. We used the manual for Fort Knox. For those of you who don't know, there are no detainees in Fort Knox. There are no humans in Fort Knox. Fort Knox does not guard humans, it guards money. So we were using a manual in a fake facility to be taught how to guard money when we were going to Guantanamo. The guys who were training us had never been to Guantanamo. They worked in stateside prisons. So they weren't necessarily aware of the conditions we were going to be dealing with. They didn't know anything about Islam. They didn't understand the detainees. They didn't know what we were getting ourselves into. Has anybody in this room seen Jersey Shore on MTV? If you guys can imagine this, we had no criminals to train with. In New Jersey, of all places, we had no criminals. I know there are criminals in New Jersey. I've seen Jersey Shore, there's plenty of them. Nonetheless, for half the day, I would be the bad guy, and half the day, I would be the good guy. We really had to use our imagination to do this training, a lot of imagination. The Army doesn't necessarily give the best of training when it should. Maybe the Army thought that Guantanamo was not a sufficient enough deployment to bother with training. It wasn't Iraq. Iraq was a war zone. I get that. You know, you need to train soldiers going to Iraq. They need to know what they're getting themselves into. But Guantanamo is a different beast in itself. No human is born with the disposition of knowing and wanting to torture and abuse other humans. It's just not how we were created. I don't care if there's anybody in the room who's not a Muslim. Whatever you believe in, God does not prepare us by birth to want to torture and abuse other people. It does not come natural. So to not give us the proper training, that's probably setting up disaster here. While this training was taking place, whenever there were three soldiers together, which would be referred to as a team, maybe nine soldiers, which would be a squad, 30 soldiers, which would be a platoon, or whenever all the soldiers of the company were together, somebody from our leadership would address us to tell us about the men of Guantanamo. They would tell us what to expect in Guantanamo. This was our cultural awareness training. When we get to Guantanamo, do not be complacent. The men in Guantanamo are the worst of the worst. They're Al-Qaeda, they are the Taliban. They hate you. They hate freedom. They hate democracy. They hate Christianity. They hate everything that you represent. They hate America. They will kill you. You think MMA has got it going on? You think cage fighters got it going on? These men can kill you in a split second with just their hand alone. Do not turn your back. Do not be complacent. Every once in a while, if it was just a few soldiers, maybe just 3 to 5 soldiers, you'd hear some more colorful words, you know. Do not be complacent when we get to Guantanamo. These aren't humans. These are lower than humans. These are the worst of the worst. These are dirt farmers and towelheads and sand niggers and camel jockeys. They kill you. They hate you. Remember what happened to us on 9/11. Remember. We finished our 2 weeks of wonderful training. We got on a plane in Fort Dix, New Jersey to fly down to Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. We landed 45 minutes later, and I thought to myself, there's only two possibilities. One, somebody forgot to fill up the plane. Or two, we went through a wormhole. Now, obviously, wormholes, you know, that's not what happens. So. We get off the plane, and we look around, and there's all these tall buildings, and it's smoggy and dirty, and there's halal food on every corner. And I realized we were in New York City. Our commander had arranged for us to go to Ground Zero that day. He wanted Ground Zero to be the last piece of the U.S. that we saw. We walked around, we saw the rubble, we saw the flowers, we saw the flags and the pictures, we saw the comments written on the wall. He wanted us to genuinely feel it. He wanted us to take it in, you know. Not what you see on TV. He wanted us to be there. He wanted us to be ground zero there. Exactly. Never forget. And as we were getting back on those planes to go to Guantanamo, he told us, I know you've heard it many times before, men, but when we get to Guantanamo, do not be complacent. When we get to Guantanamo, I want you to remember what happened here. I want you to remember the 3,000 innocent Americans that woke up and went to work and died for no reason. I want you to remember the 3,000 lives that America lost here. I want you to remember what those terrorists did to us. I want you to remember what Islam did to us. As we were flying down to Guantanamo, truth be told, I was worried. I was scared. I was, at that point in time, I didn't have, you know, the figure that I have now. I was about 130, 140 pounds. I was a small guy. I was concerned. I was worried. I'm going to be dealing with the worst of the worst, with Al-Qaeda and the Taliban, whoever they are. I never got a clear answer on who they were. The army didn't tell me. They just said they were the worst of the worst. I was envisioning in my mind Charlton Heston and Anthony Quinn. I was expecting men in each cell that were going to be on horseback with prolific beards and giant swords. And no matter what way they would turn their head, the wind would always be blowing into their beard. That was what I was expecting. We land in Guantanamo. For those of you who don't know, it's pretty darn close near the Tropic of Cancer. So we're running at about 98 degrees year-round, 100% humidity. It's hot. Real hot. Not like New York hot, not like Saudi Arabia hot. This is a different type of hot altogether. This is hot where you walk outside and you need a shower within 3 minutes. Because you've just sweat out all the water. You're done. You're hot. And as we start approaching Camp Delta to begin our initial tour of where we're going to be working, and seeing the detainees, and seeing the people who would be teaching us, the distance from about here to that back wall, that was how close we were to the camp when I was able to smell Camp Delta. What I mean by smell Camp Delta, you've got 780 Muslims from 46 different countries, for lack of a better word, cooking in Camp Delta. I mean, do not be fooled. There's nothing more than aluminum siding and concrete blocks. It's not fancy. There's no air conditioning. It's just living in the outside. These men are cooking 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And if they're not cooperative with interrogators, if they're not cooperative with the MPs, if they're not cooperative, if they do anything wrong, slightest infraction of rules, the first privilege we take away from them is the right to shower. Because if a detainee doesn't have wudu, he can't pray. If a detainee can't pray, we break his deen. If we break his deen, he shares his information. Slightest thing that they would do wrong, we would take away their right to shower. So some of these men were only showering once a month, some twice a month. Some were fortunate in getting to shower once a week. Needless to say, the men smelled. I'm not saying this to put them down. This is just reality. This is the description. Then you have the smell of the guards. Now, guards, we could go home at the end of the day. We could go home and polish off a bottle of Jack Daniels and have a couple Baconators and smoke a pack of cigarettes and listen to Slayer. Just feel real good about ourselves because we tortured and abused detainees all day. We were evening the score for 9/11. But most of us would wake up the next morning hungover. And we wouldn't take a shower the next morning because we were late. So we'd be getting to work just on time, and we'd be smelling of what we drank the night before, and we'd be sweating that out all day long. So many of the guards smelled bad too. Then you have the military working dogs. They just defecate wherever they please, and nobody comes up and cleans up after them. So you've got piles of dog poop here and there. That smells. Then you have the lack of running sewage in Camp Delta. That's another problem altogether. There are PVC pipes underneath the cells that were meant to collect the sewage, that were meant to collect the waste, but they would usually get clogged. And until a soldier did something wrong, nobody cleaned out those pipes. Sometimes 3 days, 4 days, sometimes 5 days went by that urine and feces was collecting in these pipes, cooking in the sun, just like the detainees. From here to that wall was how close I had to be to smell Camp Delta. And it would sting your nose. I mean, it literally was an awful smell. And as you start walking in, you get this other aura, the sounds of the camp. You've got all the dogs barking, you've got the generators going, you've got all the gators going around. Gators, I should explain that. Gators are kind of like golf carts that you use for transferring people to and from. So you've got all these gators going around, and the dogs, and the generators, the soldiers, the cells opening and closing, the people yelling, the people crying, the people being tortured. And then you have 18 different languages being spoken at any given moment. You've got Arabic and Urdu, Pashto, Uyghur, Punjabi, Farsi, Malaysian, Indonesian, French, Italian, Spanish, Portuguese, German, whatever people in Finland speak. Finnish? Finnish? That sounds weird. I don't know what they speak, to be honest with you. I'm sorry. But none of the detainees were speaking English, obviously. That would have been too convenient. So as I'm walking in, I'm hearing all this, I'm smelling all this, I'm seeing this, the sun's blinding me, I'm starting to cook. It's kind of this surreal moment. It's almost like an out-of-body experience. And then I heard something familiar, and it snapped me out of it, snapped me back to reality. Seven cells down on the left-hand side of the first block we walked into, I heard a detainee rapping Eminem from the top of his lungs. And I thought to myself, wait a second, hold on. The army told me that these Muslims, they hate America. They hate freedom. They hate music. They hate democracy. They hate Christianity. They hate white people. What's this guy doing rapping Eminem? And as we start passing this cell, I look at him, I go, hey, what are you doing rapping Eminem? You're not allowed to rap. You're a Muslim. I know about you. The army told me about you. You guys hate America. You hate freedom. You hate music. You hate women. I've seen it on the news. I know what you do to them. What are you doing rapping? And he says to me, when I go to interrogation, the interrogator will chain me to the ground. And he'll cover me in a bucket of ice water, and he'll turn the AC down to 40. He puts a strobe light in front of my face, and then he puts on the same song until I defecate or urinate myself. And once I defecate or urinate myself, he comes in and asks me questions, asks me for information, asks me to share my intelligence. I don't have any intelligence to share with him. So it happens the next day, and the next day, and the next day. But tomorrow, when I go to interrogation, I'm going to start singing the song before he turns it on. I'm going to show him that it's not bothering me, that it's not affecting me. He went to interrogation the next day. He started singing Eminem. The interrogator got very upset and sent him back to the block. The interrogator stopped doing that to him. Unfortunately, the SOP for Guantanamo, the standard operating procedures for Guantanamo, are written in very gray terminology. It leaves a lot of room for interpretation, both for the guards and for the interrogators. You can go home tonight and download it. Just go home and type in GITMO SOP. You can download it and read what our rules of engagement are for the detainees. That interrogator stopped chaining him to the ground and stopped abusing him in that method, but we had other methods that we would use with detainees. If detainees had a fear of dogs, it might not be uncommon to see a military working dog let loose on the detainee during interrogation. If the detainee was afraid of confined spaces, perhaps he would be put to a coffin-like device for hours dealing with his claustrophobia. If he had an issue with scorpions or snakes or insects, perhaps some insects would be put in the coffin with him. Maybe this detainee should just happen to be fortunate enough to get the one female interrogator. We had one female interrogator in Guantanamo. She had a specialty that the guards knew her for. She would usually start off her interrogations fully clothed. By the end of her interrogation, she would no longer be fully clothed. As her articles of clothing would come off, she would make suggestive innuendos, suggestive comments, suggestive gestures towards the detainees, trying to arouse them, trying to break them. And if it didn't work, if she didn't get the results that she desired, she would reach her hand into her undergarments and she would wipe a fluid on the detainee's face, and we'd be told to turn the water off in that detainee's cell. So that way that detainee couldn't wash it off and he couldn't pray. As we were doing these things, these detainees, as we were torturing them and abusing them day after day, I start looking around and taking inventory about what's going on. How are the detainees handling it? How are the guards handling it? What's going on? What's the bigger picture? What are we trying to achieve? And there's one big thing staring me in the face before I can really start thinking about the global picture. That's the fact that the detainees are waking up day after day and they're getting tortured and abused and they're able to deal with it. They're able to pray. They're able to believe there's a God in this universe that cares about them. But the guards, they can't deal with it. The guards are going home and drowning themselves in alcohol night after night to deal with what they're doing in the camp. The guards are miserable. They have all the freedom in the world, and the guards are miserable. Detainees have no freedom whatsoever. The only thing the detainees have is Islam, and it's enough. It's all they need. When I came to this realization, I decided that maybe the army hadn't told me the truth about Islam. Maybe I needed to learn some more about Islam. Maybe I should start asking some questions. I went back and found that detainee who was rapping Eminem, and I asked him, why is it you guys pray so much? Did you forget what you were praying for in the morning, and you prayed again, and you remembered, and you forgot it again, and you prayed again? Just write it down, you won't have to pray so much, man, it's easy. Why are you guys always praying that way? What's that way? What's that box that you're praying to? Do you think that that box has God? Do you think that God lives in that box? Do you even believe in God? I mean, think about the questions that you would have if you weren't born a Muslim. Think about the questions you would have if you went through the American educational system. You don't learn about Islam in the American educational system. It's not mentioned. I knew nothing about Islam when I went to Guantanamo. At all. I knew nothing. And I would ask the detainees these questions. They wouldn't get offended. They wouldn't get upset. They wouldn't get mad that I was asking them questions. It wasn't as if I was imposing upon their day. They didn't have pressing matters. They weren't trying to go get the new iPhone 6. All they wanted to do was wake up, read their Quran, live their deen. And if they could do that, that was a good day. Torture and abuse aside, it was still a good day if they could wake up and live their deen. They would answer my questions and go about their business. They wouldn't go into da'wah mode. They wouldn't tell me about how I was kufar and I was going to burn in the hellfire if I didn't accept Islam. They wouldn't tell me, oh brother, it would be good for you if only you knew. SubhanAllah. They didn't bother. They would answer my question and go about their day. It didn't take much to figure out that the difference between the guards and the detainees was Islam. It didn't take much for me to realize that I had been lied to by the army about Islam. One brother who I had developed a very close relationship with, Brother Ahmed Irachidi. Those of you who donated were given a copy of my book, and if you look, you'll see that the person who wrote the foreword for my book is none other than Brother Ahmed Irachidi.
Where was he from?
Morocco. Detainee 590, also known as the General. Oh yeah, for those of you who were here for Chaplain Yi, I'm sure Chaplain Yi talked about the General as well. He was a very important individual in Guantanamo. I will explain why. Brother Irachidi asked me to open up the beanhole one day for his door. The beanhole was where we'd serve the food. It's about this big. He asked me to open up the beanhole, and I said, why? It's not time for food. I can't open this up. I'll get in trouble. I'll get yelled at. And he told me he wanted to give me his Quran. The significance behind this is that in Guantanamo, you only get one Quran. When you arrive, they ask you what language you speak, and they give you a Quran in that language. And if an interrogator destroys it, oh well, you don't get another one. If a dog chews on it or pees on it, oh well, you don't get another one. If a guard does something to it, you don't get another one. If you forget it somewhere, you don't get another one. I don't know if you guys know, there's no Wi-Fi in Guantanamo. So you can't go to Amazon.com or Jerusalem.com and get another Quran. You get one. For him to give me the Quran meant that he was going to spend the rest of his life and for all intent and purpose die without a Quran in his possession. It meant that much to him that I take it home and read it.
Was it in English?
Yes, it was the Abdullah Yusuf Ali, the meaning of the Holy Quran. I took it home and I read it. And at the end of the third night, I remember thinking to myself that this was the first time and the only time that I've ever read a religious book that has made sense. From the beginning to the end, it is the easiest religious book to read. It's the easiest religious book written because it is an instruction manual for a living. You want to know how to get in Jannah? The instructions are right there for you in the Quran. It's that simple. Easiest religious book ever written. I wasn't convinced that I wanted to be a Muslim at that point, but I decided that maybe I should take Islam for a test drive. Maybe I should try some of these things out. Maybe I should change some of my life practices and see how it goes. You stop smoking a pack of cigarettes every day, you start breathing, you start feeling better, you start running better. I get it. That's why those Muslims don't smoke. I get it. Some of those Muslims don't smoke. I get it, yeah. You stop having a bottle of Jack Daniels every day after work, and you wake up and you don't have a hangover, you feel better about your day. It's easier to get through your day. I get it. That's why those Muslims don't drink. You stop listening to Slayer every day. You stop playing violent video games. You stop watching The Shining every night before you go to bed. You start thinking clearly. You start thinking about good stuff. You start having better thoughts. I get it. That's why those Muslims do productive things with their times. That's why they involve themselves with dhikr instead of what I'm doing. Each one of these steps that I was taking towards Islam, my life was getting much better. Each one of these steps I was taking towards Islam, Allah was taking many steps towards me. I decided that I wanted to embrace Islam around December. We had been in Guantanamo for roughly 6 months at that point. I wanted to embrace it with Brother Arachidi. I mean, he'd given me the Quran. He obviously wanted to lead me down this road. Yes?
Did you keep it a secret that you wanted to embrace Islam?
No. I did not keep it a secret that I wanted to embrace Islam. I didn't keep it a secret that I objected to what we were doing there. I didn't keep it a secret that I thought what we were doing was wrong and un-American and went against every moral fiber of my being. And to do that, to say that, I was told, you need to get with the program. You need to get with the program, soldier. You need to stop being a sympathizer. You need to stop seeing things their perspective. You need to stop talking to them. They're not humans. Remember what they did to us on 9/11. I wanted to say my shahada. I wanted to embrace Islam with Brother Arachidi. Unfortunately for me, Brother Arachidi was part of another torture method that we used in Guantanamo called the frequent flyer program. And it entails is that every hour, maybe 2 hours, we would move him from one cell to another cell, from one block to another block, from one camp to another camp, from isolation to general population, from maximum to minimum. We would move him around every hour or two so that way he couldn't sleep. We were trying to keep him up for a month. We figured that if we could keep him awake for a month's time, he would share all of his information with us. It would break him. See, what DOC, what the Department of Corrections couldn't figure out, what the Army couldn't figure out about Brother Arachidi, the reason he was so well respected by the rest of the population wasn't because he was a general, wasn't because he was some great mujahideen, it was because of his knowledge, because of his fiqh. He knew the Quran inside and out. He didn't need the Quran. That's why he gave it to me. He knew his hadith. He knew Bukhari. He knew Muslim. He knew his deen well enough that he could walk onto a block and say silence and everybody would stop talking. Or he could say riot and everybody would riot. They didn't need an explanation why. They knew that if he was saying it, there was a valid reason. And because he was so well respected by the rest of the population, that's why the army went after him. That's why they were torturing him and abusing him. They didn't understand that it was just religious respect. December 29th came. I was working the night shift, and I saw Brother Arachidi on my block. And I walked up to him, and I said, hey, man, thank you for giving me the Quran. Thank you. You know, I read it, and I started doing these things, and it's making my life much better, and you know, I think I want to become a Muslim. You know, what do I got to do? I want to be a Muslim. And he turns, and he looks at me, and he says, no. Just like the recruiter, no. Now, I had asked other detainees. They said it was okay to be white and be a Muslim. So I knew that it wasn't because I was white. And some of them had said that, you know, it's okay to be a Muslim and have tattoos. You know, you made mistakes. It's okay. You can become a Muslim. So I knew it wasn't because of the tattoos. So I was really scratching my head. Why did he say no? I mean, these are the best words that a Muslim can hear. Here's this gringo, and he wants to become a Muslim? Unfortunately, I couldn't stop and argue with them. I had things I had to do. I had to collect the trash. I had to clean the block. I had to make sure that nobody was trying to commit suicide. I had to make sure that nobody was trying to escape. About an hour later, I came back and I said to him, I can't accept no. I can't accept no. Why would you say no? Why would you give me a Quran and then when I tell you I want to be a Muslim, you say no? I mean, you led me down this road. You answered my questions. Why would you say no? Am I not good enough? Why can't I be a Muslim? And he asked me, why do you want to be a Muslim? And I rattled off some of the most ridiculous reasons anybody has ever said about why they wanted to be a Muslim. I started talking about how my first boss was from Iraq, and I would go to his house during Christmas, and this, that, and the other. Aladdin is by far my favorite Disney movie. I started talking about stuff that had nothing to do with Islam. He tells me to shut up. Sit down, let the adults speak. You understand, as a soldier in the United States Army, if you become a Muslim, the Army is going to look at you differently. You understand, with that flag on your shoulder, your country is going to look at you differently. You got a ring on your finger, your wife is going to look at you differently. Your family is going to look at you differently. Everything about your life is going to change. When you come to work, I can smell what you drank the night before. This is going to have to change. You've got nicotine stains on your fingers. This is going to have to change. When you talk, you speak like a sailor. This is going to have to change. You've got these tattoos, these holes all over your body. This is going to have to stop. Do you really know what you're getting yourself into? Do you really know what it means to be a Muslim? Do you know what you are affirming? Do you know what you are denying? Do you know what it means? Anybody in this room have a teenager? Teenagers know everything, right? I was a 19-year-old white American. I knew everything, yeah. I know what I'm getting myself into. I know all about Islam.
I agree with that.
I've been studying Islam for 3 months. I know it all. I just don't know that all I have to do is say my Shahada. Really? So he asks me for a 3x5 card and a pen, and I give it to him. And in the middle of the night, in the dark, with handcuffs, he transliterates Shahada for me. He slips it back through the cell, and he says, "You need to say this and mean it, and then you'll be a Muslim." I'm like, "That's it? There's no candles and incense or a funny bath or something like that? I just gotta say this, I'm a Muslim? Oh man, give me that card." Shadow Anna. Who's Anna? I didn't read anything about Anna in the Quran. You guys haven't told me about Anna. Who's Anna? Oh, Anna. Anna for him. Anna. A shadow Anna la 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 la. Just a bunch of L's and A's. What is this, man? Took me a while. Took me a few tries. But eventually, ashhadu anna la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu rasuluh. I knew that I had said it right when his face lit up and the other detainee's face lit up, and I started saying all of these statements ending in Allah. Mashallah, alhamdulillah, subhanallah. I didn't know what they were saying. I've been a Muslim for 4 seconds. And then at that point, Brother Irchidi and I had a conversation. And that conversation is probably the most beneficial and important conversation I've ever had about Islam in my life. I mean, I've been on Umrah. I had a very privileged Umrah. I was invited by the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia to go on Umrah. I was given all kinds of preferential treatment. They cleared out the Rawdah just for me to pray there. I had a very, very nice experience. I've traveled to many countries. I've spoken in half the states in this country. I've been doing this for 5 years. I would have never thought that being a Muslim would have got me to travel so many places, you know? Alhamdulillah, I've been blessed. But out of all the sheikhs who I've spoken with, all the imams I've met, all of these great figures, not to put any of them down, but out of all of these people, the most important conversation I've ever had about Islam was right then and there with Brother Irchidi. He told me that when you go home, you're gonna find a masjid near you. You're gonna go there, and they're gonna tell you how to dress. They're going to tell you how to eat. They're going to tell you how to fast and how to break your fast. They're going to tell you how to pray. They're going to tell you what to go to school for. They're going to tell you what to do with your life, where to work, who to marry, why to marry them. They're going to tell you all of these things, and they're going to tell you that it's because of Islam. They're not going to explain why. They're just going to tell you this is Islam. And if you want to know what Islam really is, if you want to really understand it, if you really want to feel it, if you want to be the way that we are, you need to keep reading. You don't put that Quran down. When you finish it, you pick it up again. When you finish the Quran, go get more books. Go get some hadiths. Go get some fiqhs. You need to keep reading and keep learning. Because what that masjid is going to teach you, what those people are going to teach you, is their Islam. Their country's Islam, their interpretation of Islam. And who are they? They're not scholars. They're not the Sahaba. They're not the companions. They don't know. They are teaching you their conceptions of Islam. And they may be misconceptions. And if you want to know, you need to learn on your own. Most important fact that I've ever been told about Islam, right then and there. Keep reading and learning on my own. Now I could spend the next few minutes talking about how the army reacted and how the soldiers reacted and the guards and the detainees and my wife and my family and all that stuff. But I could talk about a few things that I think are a bit more important. And since I'm the speaker, I'm going to talk about the things that I think are a bit more important. I left Guantanamo 10 years ago. When I was in Guantanamo, there were 4 facilities. When I was in Guantanamo, there were 780 detainees. That was the maximum population. Since then, we have sent over 80% of the detainees home. The most recent statistic from the Department of Defense is that 92% of the men we initially captured are innocent. That means only about 60 of the guys are guilty of something. We've had over 12 years to at least falsify charges on them, and we haven't managed to do that. So after 12 years, no charge, no trial, no conviction. I thoroughly believe that the innocent men who are still in Guantanamo will be home. Before this year ends, they will go home. I'll explain to you why. When I was there, there was 4 camps. Now there are 8 camps. When I was there, it took 600 men to run Guantanamo. Now Guantanamo can be ran by 30. When I was there, the maximum population it could hold was 900 men. Now we're nearing 1,600. We just awarded a $415 million contract to an English company to renovate and expand Guantanamo further. Under no way, shape, or form is there any possible way that you can believe we're closing Guantanamo? It's not going to happen.
Why a British company?
Because they won the bid. We are not going to close Guantanamo. We have had it for over a century. It is a perpetual lease between us and Cuba. We have 64 square miles of torture soil, and we pay $2,000 a year for that lease. We can do whatever we want there. We're never going to give it up. Japanese and Germans were held there during World War II. Vietnamese have been held there. Koreans have been held there. Iraqis and Kurds were held there. Every conflict, we have held people in Guantanamo. What is going on there now is nothing new. But what will be new, what is happening now that we have not seen, we're killing American civilians. The government is authorizing the execution of Americans. Anwar al-Awlaki was an American, make no mistake, and we killed him. It was authorized. We killed her. We killed his son a week later out of fear of retaliation. Those are the first 2 of 5 American citizens that have been authorized to be killed. As Brother Khalil said, National Defense Authorization Act of 2011, Title 10. Everybody in this room is eligible to go to Guantanamo. Every one of you. It doesn't make a difference if you're an American. You do not have the right to due process. You do not have the right to an attorney. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. You are all eligible to go to Guantanamo. My fear is that we're not going to do something about it until it's too late. My fear is that we are not going to do something about it until people from our communities start disappearing. And it is happening. Last night we were in North Carolina. We were giving a talk, and it just so happened that one of the mothers in the audience, her son, Zaid Yagi, right here, 31.5 years was what he was sentenced. Do you want to know what it was? Do you want to know what his crime was? Do you want to know how it was read? We, the jury, find the defendant guilty of providing material support to an unknown organization by an unknown means at an unknown time and an unknown date. What did he do? 31.5 years. What did he do?
Question, if you don't mind.
Go ahead.
When he was tried in court, did they give him a jury or was the judge his jury?
Jury.
Jury.
Of people watching Peter King and Fox and CNN and all the other wonderful things that we get to deal with on a daily basis.
Remind me.
Be on our email list or at least stay in touch with us. Please fill this out. And now we would like to open it up to Q&A. We would like you to be able to ask us any question that's on your mind before you go home tonight so that we can make sure you get what you came for. And I'm going to start with my sister from CARE in the back. Go ahead, sister.
I respect you tremendously. I've known you for about 8 years now, longer than that maybe. We've worked on cases together.
Yes.
I just have one correction for the brother. CARE Iowa and CARE National is the other organization that works for your civil rights and liberties, and we have done thousands of hours of work in the state of Iowa.
Yeah,
thousands of hours, and if we could have a fundraising like this, we would raise $20,000 in a few minutes too.
And so
unfortunately, we were denied this opportunity many times, but we're the ones that do the work here.
Let me add to what you're saying tonight. As an organization, CARE has 33 chapters around the U.S. CARE has been providing education, advocacy, and legal work on behalf of the Muslim community for over two decades now, since 1984. And we, as the Muslim Legal Fund, always get requests for help. The first thing we do is send each request to CARE to see if they have the resources or the talent to deal with the issue. They have lawyers in many of their chapters. Some of their lawyers have skill sets in immigration, some in criminal, some in civil. So they do a variety of cases at national. They've got a staff of attorneys that are working on cases. So together they do a lot of legal work. Wherever their work ends is where the Muslim Legal Fund begins. We have no desire to compete with CARE. We have no desire to replicate CARE. We have no desire to do education advocacy and what CARE does. We think the two organizations should be empowered to represent the Muslim community all the way through. So where CARE ends is where the Muslim Legal Fund begins.
And the other thing is, just one more thing, my father was the first Muslim at Guantanamo. He was a United States Marine stationed there in 1950.
MashaAllah.
And when he died, he passed away 4 years ago in October. One of his biggest regrets was that he was actually at Guantanamo because he felt that someday something terrible was going to happen there, and it did.
Yeah, just to make it clear, why Guantanamo is such a big deal, and why this 64 miles that we pay $2,000 a year is so special, is that this piece of land is outside of international law. There are no laws that govern Guantanamo. Zero. So you can't violate international law by doing something inside of the grounds of Guantanamo. And as long as that's the case, you can imagine paying $2,000 a year for a state-of-the-art facility that has no rules what it can be used for.
What's Outback Steakhouse's logo? No rules? Just right?
Next question. Yes, sir.
I was asking about how often, because of the Patriot Act, you could be taken off the street, no charge, indefinitely, correct?
So actually, it's not the Patriot Act. It's the National Defense Authorization Act. Let me explain that. In December of 2011, Obama passed a law called the National Defense Authorization Act. He said that as the Commander-in-Chief of the United States Army, which he is, he's the general, right? He said that all generals in warfare on the battlefield have the right to prosecute a war. You do not have to have civil rights and civil liberties in battle. I don't walk up to you and before I shoot you, take you to court, find you guilty, then shoot you. We just fight. We're fighting, right? So there's different rules of warfare. He says, as the commander-in-chief, his war on terror is global. The battlefield is everywhere. So without limits to boundary, he says, as commander-in-chief, I should be able to order the army or law enforcement to pick up or detain anyone, anywhere, for whatever reason I deem necessary. Put them in detention. I don't have to charge them with a crime. I don't have to allow them access to an attorney. There are no time limits for how long I can hold them, including U.S. citizens on American soil. So as the commander-in-chief on the war on terror, he says I can do this to anybody, anytime, anywhere, which violates every single principle and foundation this country was born with. We have a lot of questions. How often does this happen? Well, 780 people were put in there. More are coming. You don't know how many are happening because you don't know where they are when they're gone.
That's right.
Allahu Akbar. Yes, sir, in the back.
I just have two comments. One was to the sister. I'm
Muslim.
I didn't serve on the wars since GITMO. We never received a request from CARE to hold the fundraising. The other comment is whenever I read an article in the news that Guantanamo committed suicide. I never believed it. Because of our faith.
It's because it's impossible. You can't commit suicide in Guantanamo. There's a guard walking by you every 30 seconds. You have detainees all around you. Even if you're in isolation, I can project. I'm good. It's impossible to commit suicide in Guantanamo. Maybe we get a little too abusive, maybe we get a little too aggressive, a little too thirsty for results, and then perhaps somebody dies. And then maybe we just happen to say that was a suicide. Because that looks better in the media than, you know what, we killed this guy.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
So after you converted to Islam and you came back home, how did your family and your wife and your friends, how did they react?
Do you have $20?
You have $20? He's going to give you a book that has all of the answers.
You can buy this book and read all about it.
Oh, okay. Great.
My wife figured out while I was in Guantanamo that she preferred the company of the Marines to the Army, so we never had to talk about Islam because our marriage worked itself out in another means. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah. My dad passed away while I was in the service, which is fine. My mother doesn't particularly care one way or the other. She's happy that I found a religion. She doesn't really know much about what she thinks that she believes in. So she doesn't care what I believe in, because she doesn't know what she believes in. My siblings have no interest in religion because they're 18 and they know everything, or they're 17 and know everything, or they're 14 and they know everything. And I ended up remarrying just about 2 years ago, in 2 days, it'd be 2 years ago. So,
a beautiful woman who really loves Islam, and they're a wonderful couple.
Yeah, she corrects me all the time. Like, if I get angry about something, you know, is that how the Prophet would have responded? Is that how the Prophet would act? You need to check yourself. She's quick to put me in my place, but the thing about it that's best is that she knows what she's talking about. She can almost always back up what she's saying with a sound hadith or a fact or a story from the companions. She knows what she's saying.
Sounds like a good wife.
Yes, sir.
I looked up.
With regard to Guantanamo, is it implied that Obama, when he says they want to close it, is just political speech making?
If I gave you $1,000, would you vote for me?
Okay. Well, there's a difference between what he's misleading the country and what he's saying he cannot get Congress to vote.
Here's the problem. He may have good intentions, a lot of them. I don't know what's in his head or his heart. But the fact is, for $2,000, you get 64 acres and a multi-billion-dollar facility that has no rules. Are you going to give it up?
Well, there's a difference between moving the detainees out vis-a-vis retaining the
detainees. Yeah, out of the 780 men, there were down to 146 left. Half of them have already been approved to go home. Yet after torturing for 12 years, the country wanted to send to Yemen or Somalia, whatever, are afraid to they might be radicalized, so we don't know what to do with them. So there's a dilemma as to how to release people who've been traumatized for the rest, and there are a few people they still consider guilty.
Because there's a differentiation between closing Guantanamo and moving the detainees. I concur, or we all concur, Guantanamo will never be closed.
Right.
But there's one other important factor that we wrote to Senator Grassley almost a year ago. They're putting a new state-of-the-art cardiac center in Guantanamo. It was commissioned, I think, just about a year ago, maybe last November, which even many of our hospitals do not have.
Yeah, we have no intent on closing it. He said it to get elected, and we fell for it. And then he said it again 4 years later, and we fell for it again. Shame on us. I mean, our only other option was a sociopath. If he voted for Mitt Romney, he would have been just as badly damned as you know, voting for Obama again.
Yes, sir.
I said, I don't know why. All praise be to Allah for guiding us. I mean, I want to know concerning the organization in which you all are representing, if it's a fact that most American citizens who do not know about Islam is often chosen to be jury, or if the judge himself is opposed to Islam and he is the jury, how is your representation going to be heard?
Well, in the U.S. courtroom, you have a process that's called voir dire. It's Q&A between the lawyer and the potential juror as to what they think about the case. And in that process, you get to ask them a lot of questions, and based on their answers, you decide their bias. If you can find bias in their answers, they can disqualify themselves and be dismissed. So there is a very intense effort at this point to develop surveys and questions that will bring out the true feelings of people and their attitude towards Islam and Muslims before you ever allow them to sit on a jury. And we are going to take the lead in putting a lot of effort into that questionnaire so that all criminal defense attorneys that go to court and have a Muslim can use that questionnaire to better select jurors. You're welcome. I'll get to yours in just a minute. Somebody had asked about Ziad Yagi's case. Who was that? Somebody had...
Nobody asked, but I just mentioned it. It's
revealed. Okay. Who else? What other questions? Yes, ma'am.
So have you heard about Omar Khadr?
Omar Khadr? In Canada?
Yeah.
I know him very well.
Oh.
I was in Guantanamo with him, spent a year with him. I know him very well.
Wow.
I visited his family in Canada in 2011.
Uh-huh.
I interviewed them. Spent about a good 45 minutes to an hour talking with them and whatnot. And I yelled at a lot of people in Canada.
Yeah.
I was doing this in Canada, not for the Muslim Legal Fund. I was just going and talking about Guantanamo at Masajid in Guantanamo, or in Canada. And when I would finish my lecture, I would usually conclude with telling them, the reason Omar Khadr is still in Canada is because of you. Congratulations, you're failing.
Yeah.
Kind of a mean way to end things, but that was the truth of the matter. They weren't trying to get him home. When they did put effort into it, they got him home, and he got an additional, I think, 7 years that he had to serve in Canada. But yes, I know him very well, and I hope to God when he gets out that he will have a good support group established, because he's literally been locked up since he was 14. He's going to need a support group to reintegrate into society.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'll come to you in just a second. I'll ask a sister from CARE. Go ahead.
Me? Okay.
Yes.
Have you met Junye? Do you know him?
I was there with him. I worked with him.
Okay, that's what I thought. He was here not long ago. He's a good friend of mine. And I don't know if you know anything about what's going on with him now, but the man is suffering. He's suffering terribly. He's homeless. His family has left him.
James Yee?
James Yee.
He was the director for CARE in New Jersey,
yes.
And he stepped down.
He stepped down because
I
don't want to go
into details. I heard from him, his side. So after that, he hasn't been able to find anything?
No, he has PTSD, basically. And he hasn't been able to hold his life together. But he's homeless, he's suffering, and he's still being prosecuted and persecuted. Yeah.
Wow.
So it's just, you have come out on the good end.
Have him give me a call. I'd like to talk to him.
Would you?
Yes.
Have him call AmVets.
He's working with vet groups now, and they're giving him a place to live. He's living in a homeless shelter for vets. And he's working with a group called Paper.
Right, but with regards to the PTSD, though, if he works with AmVets, they shouldn't have any trouble getting him rated at 100%. If they get him rated 100%, he'll have a $3,100 monthly income tax-free for the rest of his life.
He gave up his pension. Does that make a difference?
Yeah, the pension is different from disability. Yeah, the pension, that's fine.
He
give that up, it has nothing to do with it. But if he's suffering from a significant amount of PTSD, then yeah, they'll diagnose it and it'll be taken care of.
Yes, sir.
This question is about his brother.
Didn't do it.
It's not necessarily a question.
Yes,
I really want you to share some enlightenment for me. An individual who's not a Muslim, who finds himself in your situation, who maybe took a shahada in the military, could you give us something that can be beneficial for this person? And also for a person who's already a Muslim, who's contemplating on joining the service?
I would never tell anybody who's a Muslim who's contemplating joining the service not to. There's 212 careers in the military. You don't have to be involved in combat. There's plenty of things you can do. You can get an education out of it. You can become a doctor, a lawyer, a pharmacist, etc.
Okay.
All kinds of things you can do. I would never tell them not to join. With regards to your first question, there was another veteran in the room.
Yes.
He's in the midst of a conversation right now. I was going to let him go ahead and answer. Honestly, I think that having been in the military probably made becoming a Muslim easier. You know, you have to have a great deal of discipline. You have to have a lot of discipline to be a Muslim. There's all kinds of temptations around. There's sisters around. You want to glance at them. You want to look at them. You can go to the corner and buy a pack of cigarettes just like that. Liquor store is always open. Strip clubs are always open. You know, Dr. Feelgood will always have what you need.
Yeah.
Temptation is always there. It takes a lot of discipline to be a Muslim, to be a good Muslim. It takes a lot of discipline. And having been in the service, you get discipline.
Another thing I want to share with you,
that
another case we have is a young man named Craig Baxham. Craig Baxham was in the U.S. Army for 6 years. His last year in the service, he became Muslim. When he got out of the service, he lived in New York. He was around a bunch of friends who really supported him, and he liked them. And they happened to be, the majority of the group was from Somalia. So after the love, the affection, the attention, and that high that you have when you embrace Islam, he began to see living in America as a problem. He saw it as a difficulty. So he decided he wanted to move to Somalia to practice his faith. He sold all of his stuff. He bought a plane ticket. He flew into Kenya to get into Somalia. On his way through the Kenya security into Somalia, they asked him, "Why are you coming to Somalia?" He said, "I'm a new Muslim. I want to live in a Muslim country. I have a lot of friends who are Muslim that are Somali. I want to be here." They said, "Why do you want to be in Somalia?" He said, "Well, they're a country that practices Sharia. They live under Islamic law. I want to be a part of that." And they said, "Boy, do you know the only people practicing Sharia law in Somalia is Al-Shabaab? So are you telling us you want to join a terrorist organization?" And he didn't know how to answer that question. And they continued to interrogate him. And based on hypothetical questions, they decided that he had come to Somalia in a conspiracy to provide material support. They put him back on a plane. They flew him back to New York to stand trial. Now, we hired a lawyer. We fought this case. All of those charges were dismissed. Alhamdulillah. But advice to you.